It seems that it's not the best slot after the lunch, as always, that some people are always missing, but lucky to see so many people here. So welcome. So as I said, my name is Henri Kivioja. I come from Finland, but actually what I'm going to talk about is more of a Swedish culture. As you can see that I'm coming from Ericsson. It's a traditional old Swedish telecommunications company, and a lot of the things that we see also locally in Finland are coming from that culture, and I hope that I can reflect on some of those things. Maybe a couple of words of myself. As you see, my current title is Head Agile Coach, but actually for this topic I think I might be a good person to speak about. I have been in Ericsson more than 10 years, and I have been also a manager within the organization in many different positions, so hopefully I have a couple of stories, and one story is about me, and I'll try to open up how I was coached, maybe in the more agile and lean. But setting up a little bit the context what I'm talking about, that from enterprise level, lean agile is something that for management, I've been presenting this transformation story quite many times, but looking at from the management point of view, and especially traditional management, lean agile brings this kind of agile manager thing, that the things that traditional companies and corporations where are not maybe valid at all. So those things that in reality there are, those roadmaps, inefficiencies, a lot of reporting happening in different steering groups, a lot of planning. Planning as such is not a bad thing at all, but those plans, those damn plans, five-year plans that guide the organization in the right direction. Cost is visible everywhere, it's still visible. And to be really honest, in this kind of world that our company lives, the customer interaction is not very close. It's a little bit different story when you have a smaller scale companies, new business building up. But for example, for us, it might be 7 steps from a developer to customer. And that's not very agile in a way. Of course, then what we aim for is not the agile itself at all. For us, of course, the meaning of a company is business, and a business adaptation connected to that. So we foresee that the value from cost to value is really one of the key things for the whole company to survive in the midterm even. More flexible we need to be. Efficiency of course comes within these times that there is a competition everywhere. For us, maybe the competition is even harder than it has ever been. There's a really strong competitors coming from China, others as well, but mainly from China. And they are very agile, they are very fast. And if we want to stay ahead, we are still the market leader. We need to be faster, we need to be more flexible. But then comes the other part of the change what we have had, is the people part. And I have underlined this always. The people make the company, not the managers. But managers are also people. So in that sense, what I try to say, that the empowerment is not only for teams and developers and testers. It's you need to have it mutually as well. And quite often I hear that the managers this and managers that. It's quite threatening for them to go on with the change if you're always challenged. And the trust is missing, at least on some parts of the organization. But going from this lean agile transformation is towards the business agility. That's very clear now. We have done this transformation for more than 3.5 years now, and those good technical practices, they are really helping us on this. But the thing is about business, the structures that we need to break, and all of those things. Just to put up in a context that for the change, just to understand in what kind of world we live in, is that what was the starting point to start this transformation for our organization. So the product that I'm talking about, in which context all of these learnings that I'm sharing are happening, it's in a way a pretty traditional telecom product in our terms. It's nothing spectacular, but then if you enter into telecom domains, technically it's quite complex environment. It has a lot of nodes that interact real time with each other. heavy load happening all the time, really strict quality requirements, and more or less all the time calls need to be working, video need to be working. You cannot have it down ever. That is what our customers are used to, and that is the nature of the business. So complexity into the product, we have 10 million lines of code, so meaning that we have done more than 10 years already development for the product. Even 11 releases behind us. So there is a lot of working legacy already existing, and then when you fundamentally change the way of working and the whole culture, that gives a lot of constraints, of course. Then one part of the context that we live in is that the install base is huge. I have one picture a little bit later about it, just to show the magnitude of the work that we are doing. And we are doing development in many sites, and of course that creates time zone challenges, cultural challenges, different managers think in a different way. It's not only about the teams. Managers should collaborate, but if you are located far away from each other, it's not very common yet. Teams, you for example, use video conferencing very fluently. But when I'm in a so-called traditional management meeting, it's still telephone lines and a lousy quality, although we produce high definition audio and video quality. But how come the managers then don't get the use of those? These kind of things come within that perspective. So, showing just the install base that we have thousands of nodes for hundreds of customers. Customers for us are like Vodafone, China Mobile, and these kind of big players in the field. So these colors here indicate the different places that we have our stuff. Most likely here also, at least half of you every day uses our product. And it's of course our fault if it doesn't work. Okay, in this traditional type of project management and management in general, we were doing actually business-wise quite okay. As said, market leader, making big money into the company. So why on earth then to change anything? Because you already are there. So these are the things that the actual management really openly said in the beginning to all of the people, that these are the core things that were in the beginning of the transformation that must be there. So creating the most value out of our operations, doing the things that really create the ultimate value for us, because if you have a two-year project with a lot of stage gates and milestones and these kind of things, it automatically creates a lot of inefficiency. And overcoming of that, you need to kind of change the whole flow to go forward. Then the responsiveness part. But for us, if we have hundreds of thousand man hours project, when you started to do it and you planned it up in the end, the world has changed three times in those 2 years that you run that project. And it's impossible to do big changes in the end for this kind of approach. The whole nature of the work is done in wrong assumptions. So this is something that the whole organization really needs to understand. And that doesn't mean that it's the teams actually. Teams are very flexible. They can do it quite easily actually. I comparing to the part that you have these big roadmaps and contract negotiation and these kind of things that are already might be fixed for 10 years. How flexible you can be there. Then for us, as I said, quality is maybe the most important thing that is seen from our customers' perspective. And for us, the quality meant 1 year testing, maybe even 2 years testing, bug fixing, 5,000 bugs fixed in 1 year. Just do it all the time. Heavy test equipment, which costs a lot. I don't know if I should say, but I think we have of the Ericsson equipment in the world, I think we have at least 2% its number in use within our own test labs. So that tells, and we use it only for testing more or less in different products. So it's quite heavy investment from us to have this tied to bug fixing of something that's already done, or at least it should have been done. And those usages were not good. And then the people part, and in a big corporation, there is a lot of structures, hierarchies, reporting, as I said, and these kind of things. And it doesn't really empower people. It doesn't make you feel motivated that you are in your own box and go forward from that. So getting out from that is really, really important. And also empowering the managers. If you are a middle manager in a corporation like ours, you are not very empowered. You are getting touched from up and bottom all the time. You need to be there reporting up, you need to get information from down and vice versa. So it's not very empowered even there. So those were the rationales for the change when we really started back in 2008. By the way, if you have any questions, you may interrupt me. Let's try to take them in the end because we have the microphone, but I can, if there is something that I say not in a good way, please interrupt. So what we have changed, I will go this quite fast through because we are just getting to the actual topic. So from these big projects going towards decoupling these roadmaps to have a really flexible release. And I will not now touch how we have done it. If you are interested, you can come and discuss with me later on how we have structured all of those PO structures and those. I will not today talk about those at all. Then changing the organizers in the lower level has been quite successful, I would say. So going from this traditional silo organization more and more towards a horizontal organization, getting people in the same context, and giving possibility for the teams to collaborate in the end-to-end flow. We have different teams, we have cross-functional teams, we still need to have some testing teams, but they need to be able to collaborate fluently in the flow. So the organizational structure needs to support that. Then for us, a big change was from going from individual office to really open team spaces, including the management. We also I'm part of the one leadership team, so we also there have an open space and a team table. So everyone is in a team table, more or less. Going towards continuous learning and broader competencies. So getting away from component teams to cross-functional teams automatically creates that. But then looking at from management perspective, if you were responsible of that part of the product and suddenly you are collaborating with end-to-end flow, that also is a competence and learning issue for the managers. Likewise, it's for the developers. Individuals to teams, nicely said. But here, especially when I look at different leadership teams, I don't see real teams there. They don't have a common context there. They are still trying to achieve the things as managers have used to do. And how to coach that to get real teams also there? That is one of the golden guest questions, which I try to partially answer what we have learned on that. We were pretty good, damn good, I would say, of defining processes. We have made even spin-out companies that continue to make those processes in the world. And from this kind of culture, when people, managers, coaches, whoever comes, and you need to start to think on your own, you don't anymore can trust on your checklist and these kind of things. That is a fundamental change. And cultural change is so slowly that it takes years and years, a lot of changes to go from that forward. Maybe then this part then, as said, top-down control, more people, initiative and self-organization. When we started the change, it was very clear, cross-functional teams, developers, it was quite clear that you need to go there. But it's even more clear now that this also needs to apply on all layers, from first line to actually the C-level managers, going and breaking those boundaries. How we see the traditional management, what I've been talking about here, is it shouting or nice suited guys there in a row? I don't know. But for Ericsson, traditional management actually is a cultural-wise. It's quite different from, if I compare some Finnish companies, I've also worked with some others, that it has been already tens of years discussion-based culture that is built in Sweden anyway, and it's very visible in our environment. So as a base for managers also to collaborate and discuss and respect the people, it's quite easy actually. So in that sense, maybe the situation for us is not that that bad as it might be for some other companies. On the other hand, we are a multinational company that we have a lot of sites everywhere around the world. So those cultural differences, the further away you are from the headquarters in Stockholm, maybe the influence of Swedish culture is less and less. Then talking about coaching, just to put the context what I mean by coaching or agile coaching in this. So first of all, as an agile coach, you need to be a lean agile practitioner. You have a certain set or areas that you need to be able to move around. One of part is this coaching, professional coaching, how you are able to interact with the people, influence them, how you can ask powerful questions and so on. Those are the kind of traits of the professional coach. Another part of this is the mentor. As a good coach, you need to be able to be a mentor for some of the people. That is very much required. Then sometimes you need to be a teacher. You need to be able to use your own expertise to teach things to the teams, managers, and so on, to be able to go on with the coaching. And quite often in our world, coaches are also asked to be as a facilitator for a workshop or this kind of thing. But it doesn't mean that you need to stay. It's a difficult situation to be a facilitator and try to influence on all of these areas. And usually it's more or less forbidden as a facilitator to try to influence on people. But when talking about management coaching, you are not only a coach there. You must be there also a leader. And those people, especially in the middle management, they are very smart people. And if you only facilitate, then you basically cannot change anything there. It takes too much time because those workshops don't happen daily and weekly. They happen very, very rarely. And those moments when you have a chance to influence, as being given the permission to coach, you need to be able to do a really good job there. And for that, you need to have some kind of mastery. A technical mastery, if you talk with technical managers, business side people, you need to understand the business that they are living in totally. Or if you are in transformation, you need to be top-notch expert in the transformation parts. That is the minimum requirement for a coach to be even allowed to enter into those layers. And that is challenging. I like this picture. It's from Lisa's agile coaching course, which is mainly used for coaching agile teams, but this can be very much applied and make things simpler also from organizational point of view. Okay, then a little bit of experience about coaching at Ericsson Finland in our site. It's actually located in Jorvas, quite near to Helsinki. We are 800 people there, which roughly half is working in R&D in the development projects. So when we started the transformation, we initially had a couple of Scrum Masters. We started with one or two teams, and at that point of time, we started with Scrum. So naturally, we had Scrum Masters. So there we had some initial team-level learnings happening there, but only capture of the managers were actually involved in the early stages. So that already created this kind of disharmony between different managers. Why myself is not included in this first group that are able and allowed to go for this change? So then the forming of the initial communities happened, and this kind of organizational change really started to go forward. But I would say the majority of the traditional organization just was beside and looking at what the hell are those guys doing there, and not really feeling at all involved. And then naturally there become a little bit identification of this kind of people that maybe are capable of doing this kind of organizational level coaching, and maybe get this whole transformation and change faster. Then I would maybe say the next stage was that we made a real change on the organization and formed new teams to whole organization, and had a coach, as actually namely coach for each and every team. That was a good exercise as well, in a way. Unfortunately, those coaches were not maybe selected in the best possible way. Coaching is really demanding work. It's it has a really special requirements for the coaches, and we didn't understand those. So we gradually from that have been forced to make some really big changes also there regarding the coaching. And maybe people who started as coaches at that stage, they didn't even like it and they found something else. But then we also started to have those organizational learnings in place, and I think this was one of the crucial change points for us, that the whole organization was involved. All the managers also were there. So in practical terms, that this meant for the organization that all the managers lost their job and they needed to reapply. So all the positions were open. And that is something that you really notice. When you had your nice, beautiful products and sections and whatever, suddenly they disappeared. That at least is something that makes, but at least may make me think that there is really something going on here. And that created like a good momentum in the organization to go really make some radical here. And then this community of practice culture started to evolve. And there's one learning that we see that the coaches were very much with the teams and so on. But the managers felt a little bit alienated on that. What are these guys doing? Some people went there with the teams, went to this new culture, but quite many still remained in those old leadership team meetings and so on. And then we actually even appointed a couple of organizational level coaches, because that was clearly seen that it's not enough that the whole community coaches the whole organization. You also need to have some structure in the coaching part of the organization. So maybe now we are entering this third stage. These are really rough, just to give some kind of picture that this has now expanded the whole Ericsson actually. And we as an organization, we're in the forefront, so our people have now been asked to many places to go around the corporation with different products, different cultures and so on. And we more and more start to get at least those enterprise level challenges visible. How much we are then able to learn from those, that's again a quite good question. Because I think those early things were, compared to what I see now happening, quite easy. But these are really difficult. It's really difficult to change the whole corporation, especially if the corporation on certain levels doesn't even know that they need to change. And this middle management, I think it's said almost everywhere where you have anything mentioned about managers, agile or leadership, that middle management is the bottleneck. I have to say the same thing by my own experience. They don't do it on purpose at all. That's not the point. But the surroundings where the people are, it's so stuck and so there's something fundamentally wrong in that it's almost impossible to grab away from that. And there it doesn't work that you can get from a top again yet another order, and now you need to change. It doesn't change anything. It's just another form of old culture and old structures. So in order to go for this, I would maybe put a question mark towards this networked organization. A lot of this cultural thinking needs to be in place, and that takes time. That takes a lot of time and hard work in the organization. So we are more and more living in this. Of course, things are not perfect either in the way, so it's very, very simplified picture in that sense. Then I had in the beginning this empowerment. Is that kind of a buzzword? Also in all presentations you have a middle managers and empowerment. We have understood that this empowerment really means that when the people really take the full responsibility of improving their process, their work. But if it's all about the people, what it means then for the managers? I used to be part of that, the guys too. At least I felt that I was doing it together. Now the people are taking the initiative, and I'm not invited or I'm not daring to go there with them. How can I change that? What is my role in this? These kind of questions go all around the organization. So nice open spaces and things are happening for us, but for example in this picture, I don't know it very well, but there is not that many managers involved. Maybe somewhere in the beginning, and then they had a meeting at 12 when the real discussion started. So how to overcome these kind of issues? So people, yes, and managers are also people. It's a dilemma. At least some key areas that need to be touched when talking about, in this perspective, first line managers. That for us, the decision making as such was a really painful experience. How to relearn to make new kind of decisions. Understand that the people, they really can make those decisions. Here, when I talk about managers, I also include technical project managers who used to do this kind of decisions. So, do you allow the people to fail that they can learn to make better decisions next time? And as a coach or coaches in an organization, you need to be able to help the managers also. That they need to guard in the structures what we have. When we change them, we have new structures, of course. It goes gradually. But adjustment is always needed. You need to have organizational adjustments all the time, like in Agile. Not that you make a yearly reorganization, but you make those changes, are able and empowered to make those changes that are needed. And a lot of things happen with the teams. You need to be there all the time, supporting the coaches, supporting the teams and the people. Live with them. And as a coach, sometimes you need to, why don't we do it together? If it's not so hard to go there with the big people, you can show your own example, for example, there. Art of management. Management is dead and long-lived leadership. What I mean by this is that we had, I would say, hundreds of management teams. One day, they all turned to leadership teams. Hooray, leadership is now in place. No. But that's the illustration what we saw there. Then if those teams start to think, discuss, and go, there is chance that they become real leadership teams. But what is the ignition of the change for those newly named teams if there is no one challenging there, or no one guiding, supporting, and going? It might be that there are managers who take this role, but it's not very common that I have seen. Then the whole team's constellation and dynamics requires a lot of cooperation. And here is one part that Scrum doesn't say anything about what managers can do. And we didn't understand it either in the beginning, that we had a coaching community and some of the managers, and then they were, what are these guys discussing? And then once a week gathered together and encountered in the coffee machines, but really not doing it together at all. So. Now we start to understand how we do it together, but it took more than 2 years to get even to this stage for us. So really, really difficult area. Feedback and rewarding. People value the first line managers. They are important people in the organization. And they have the power to raise your salary or even fire you, more or less. But then the coaches are also all the time with the people. And do they just provide input to the manager that he makes those decisions, or how does it really work? We have experimented many ways to do it. We have this traditional IPM performance review where we have both coaches there, even teams are there, and then there's individual. So different forms of getting this. People need also this official feedback. It's not enough that you have a retrospective and you still don't talk there. So this is something, at least in our culture, that is still needed, that officially it's someone really says that where am I? How am I doing? I'm an individual. How would I go forward from that? And then the last question, what I have seen more and more, where is the HR? It's years behind those HR processes that come to this traditional part, and they try to be involved, but then on the other hand, in our company, the HR is very coming from top, and if the top is not changed, it's quite impossible for the HR people close to the people to do their work in a new way. So at least those areas of there have been painful for us. There I have one example of going in the right direction. I said this. In my opinion, maybe the most important thing for manager is to take care of the organizational competence, development, and individual. And it was done in the traditional way with the competence management plans and this kind of long-lived planning. But We are now trying out that it's a little bit messy slide, but the whole point is so that we have world-class teams. We have a changing needs all the time, and the environment is changing. We have a dynamic thing, and then we do this all the time in a round. Instead of having a yearly plan for competence management, now we need this and that. Try to adapt to the situation, changing business requirements and these kind of things. And I think this is at least path to the right direction. So people have felt quite happy about it lately. They see a change here. Then another example, I said I'm as a coach also officially part of a leadership team, and my role is to be coach there. And this is a picture of one of our workshops. We had a really good retrospective, open discussion, and this team comes from, it's a department manager level, so we are hundreds of people in under this leadership team, and it's the history is very traditional reporting and planning based approach. But more and more it's become evident that community enabling is one thing that this level, middle level managers need to do. There needs to be some kind of responsibility still within the management. Otherwise, one reason of management existing might disappear. Then we could, of course, argue, does it need to be like this or not? But at least at the moment in our company, that is still needed. And then this understanding the cultural change, how it goes, how it fosters, how you got on the new culture in different parts of the organization. Then the middle managers. For them to be able to even to try to succeed in this change, that if there is not the senior or C-level support, you don't have a sponsor for the change who understands and supports it, it's almost impossible. So that is crucial. Have to remember that those guys have worked really hard to get to their position. So pure challenging does not work at all. It needs to come in a totally different domain, those discussions, that there comes the will to change. So as a coach, you need to be accepted to be coach middle managers. It doesn't mean anything that you are, someone appoints you as a coach and then you are left out of all of these customs. So what I have seen, experience is a must. Otherwise you cannot enter there. You need to be a professional in the terms that it's the things that you do, it's seen that you would do it in a good way. And personally, might not be a bad thing at all. Those managers quite often are quite big personalities as well, so you maybe need to have something to reflect those egos there as well. One trick that has worked, at least for me, is that when you get one on your side, maybe the rest will be more easy to follow. Maybe reflecting the one of the presentations in the morning. So in Finland, it's easy, just get naked and go to sauna, and then it works. So it has worked for us as well, having beers with the guys and so on. But maybe there was a tweet from Vasco that maybe not recommended in the United States. Maybe it's not allowed there. And have to remember, pressure is coming from up and bottom, constantly, all the time, banging all the time. So you need to understand that dynamic as well. Okay, then I have 10 minutes remaining, so I have a couple of stories from real life. What I just added these slides based on the feedback in the morning after Ari's session that it was hard to follow without any slides. I was planning also to use the flip chart, but this is actually a story of me. I was a node borrow asset manager before we started this change, and I was given a task. You need to make this transformation starting in your project. Any questions? That was the more or less. And the discussion came from a really senior manager, and my first reflection was that why in hell are you coming to ruin my beautiful project? We just landed. It will end in 2 years. So how come you come here? So, of course, the change started there only. We involved external coaching who were teasing me, my team, a lot of times. Why are you doing it like this? It cannot work like this. And a lot of frustration, a lot of things that really, really, really were painful for us. And then around us, some of us entered, the community started to grow up. Management was all the time involved there, supporting us. And for me, the own initiative was maybe the thing that seeing all these things happening around me, there must be something in it. So then I was allowed to enter a new role as an Agile program manager, and then I got much more involved into the Agile and Lean, and had a lot of books, courses, discussions, and all of these that happened in the community. And now I'm this bad as a coach in the organization, and at least someone has coached me to change. So there are a lot of sources coming to me, but then I needed to change first before anything around me can be changed. Another story. At the same time, when I mentioned that we had this, everyone needed to apply for a new position, of course there came new managers as well. So there was one of my colleagues who was really young and enthusiastic about being a manager and going with the career higher in the ladders, and he was appointed to this organization who was ongoing change. A section manager means for us that you have roughly 20 people in your section, cross-functional teams there. And for him, we had a lot of discussion with that guy. So a lot of challenges what he saw in the surroundings that I tried to, in my role as a coach there, help him that what is this team up empowerment thing. He didn't get it at all. And how you make those decisions that we just need to make those and go forward. And what are these communities? I don't know. I'm not interested in those at all. And then this message that manages, it came from somewhere. I don't know where. But managers are not needed in Scrum, so why on earth am I even existing? This kind of discussion. And that was also fed from the community, that what do we do with the managers? So a lot of misconceptions and misunderstandings in the organization. And for that guy, the really challenging areas are that there were not anymore these role descriptions. They were disappearing, we abandoned them. No defined responsibility areas in the line that you have your own sandbox that you can play around, and maybe for that person the agile thinking didn't ever go through, so the passion was missing. So eventually he really got new challenges and decided to leave the company for another career. So these kind of things have happened more in a different favors for us as well. So not everyone fits in. Third story is also a colleague of mine. A long time line manager on a department level, different departments, different countries, 150 people led by him. When he came, he was part of our organization 5-7 years ago, and then he went to some other assignments. But he came back, and he came in the middle of this transformation. And then at that point of our R&D head said, "Hey, you are now a couple of laps behind from the rest of the organization." And that's quite maybe good thing to say, that you come as a new position and high energy, and now we make this change, and then first thing that you are told that, hey, you don't understand anything what is going on here. So that led that we had a lot of discussions with different people and leadership team, and eventually it was quite evident that this kind of non-existing agile roles were introduced within those management teams. And it's very much needed that as a coach, to be able to influence the managers, you need to be part of the team, not an external coach. So that's one of the crucial points. It's not very, it doesn't work if you are not part of the gang. It's just how it is. So this intimacy in the coaching, having a common experience, and really have the trust, it is vital. And I think this at least partially has been a success story for that. This guy got a higher position, and is now supporting fully the change within Ericsson with different more responsibilities, and trying to influence and change people around him as well, meeting a lot of different stakeholders. So this is a good story. Okay, coming back then. So as said, traditional management, agile manager, and for us it's about the business agility. So what is it, the whole clue about it? To getting the organization to understand these things, these values, go forward. Couple of reflections towards the end, what we really have understood from our perspective in this Ericsson Finland, and we are starting to see similar things in other parts of the organization, what we have learned in this journey in different parts, and reflecting this also to the management part. So this really making those changes based on some kind of feedback. Not only that you have the feedback when you do product development, software development, but also having this feedback, okay, this kind of setup didn't work, we need to change it, and not wait that someone else decides that you need to change the organization, or you need to make new roles, or whatever ever is needed, that get the, and learn from that, adapt into that, and go forward. And when you go higher in the ladders, it's harder and harder to make adaptive changes, because they, when you make a one box move in really high, everything under you also changes. It's so structures and connected, all of those things there. And then this thing is, this is the key point. The whole organization needs to just to accept it. If it's not accepted, then we have this chronic middle management challenge for the rest of the our lives there, if the company is still alive even. And moving from this upfront planning, living with the flow from the teams, going with the value flow, how we do the business in a new way, and how do we need to adapt the whole organization understanding around it. Going from this 10-year contracts to something totally different, new business models coming up, lean startup type of thinking in some parts of the organization, and these kind of things, good things happening there. And mostly our organization has now understood this, that this is not about processes and tools and practices as such. It's a cultural and thinking change within the organization. And when that is understood, one part of the organization starts to spread out, we have hope still remaining there. So that's one of the fuels that I can keep carrying on in my role to make this change even more and more wider in our organization. Okay, any questions?
I have a first question. If teams are taking more responsibility and kind of taking some part of self-managing role, so overall, did the number of managers decreased or stayed the same or increased or?
Unfortunately, in the first change, it say stayed more or less the same. But now I start to see that not with very drastic numbers, but we have removed a lot of managerial roles, in a way to say. So I cannot say if it's less managers, because maybe they moved to some other parts which is not yet changed as the number of managers. But at least what I see in my surroundings, that there is less and less this kind of roles needed.
So any other questions? Yep.
Usually the companies follow some like process like ITIL, and did you have this one, and if you had, how did you manage to go from like far away predefined approach to that agile thinking as well?
Yeah, for us, if I understood the question correctly, that we started the change that we went by the book approach. So we took everything and tried to take everything that was told us and make it somehow to work. And then we started to understand, this doesn't work, we need to come back. This doesn't work, we need to come back. And maybe we are now somewhere in the middle, that we understand that the things that work for us, we can use, and some things that just really don't work for us, we cannot use. If we would have gone directly to the middle, maybe we wouldn't have understood why the middle is okay, and still this kind of learning wouldn't have happened. So that is partially at least the answer.
So at the moment, how far have you done this migration from the previous way of you worked in the Ericsson to the new way? You probably are still in the process, right?
We are in the process that we have a roughly 25,000 people working in R&D, and we call them development units. We have four of those big ones. And two of those are quite far, and two have just started. So I would say that those who have started early, they have still a long way to go because the upper layers have really need to be touched, and those who have started, they have really just started. So it will take years still. That's status.
Okay, so this is a continuation from the previous question. So what did you do with the old processes?
Right. We just didn't use them anymore.
Okay. And then another question, you mentioned that like in addition to being a coach, you need to kind of be a consultant and really like push for changes. And when you get that chance to make your mark, then you need to use also those like that kind of approach. Do you find it hard to like work with to switch between those two roles, and how do you manage that?
I personally, I find it really difficult because I like when I notice that I'm in my old self. This is something familiar for me, and I like it to be part of this kind of things go, and then you discuss with your peers who are alike. And then when you notice that you need to go back, it's not about me, it's about the others as well. One illustration of that is that whenever I'm in a meeting where there is a lot of managers involved, you never get your voice heard. You need to interrupt people. You need to go in between to be even heard there. And if I would be this kind of, let's wait when I can talk, then I can talk next year. So okay. That's it needs to come somehow naturally, but it is difficult, really difficult.